Hello, my dear students. Welcome on this session. This session is about biological and psychological testing. First, we start with the biological assessment. The main purpose of biological assessment would be to rule out the known causes of psychological symptoms, the known organic medical causes of psychological symptoms. And this assessment would include physical examination of the patient, thorough physical examination of the patient, and the various laboratory tests. Why it's important? Depression and anxiety, these are the two symptoms which may be present in many medical conditions. For example, depression may be present in hypothyroidism, as well as it may be present in Addison and Cushing disease. Anxiety can also be a feature of hyperthyroidism or thyrotoxicosis. It's a very predominant symptom. It may be present in pheochromocytoma, which may be assessed by doing 24-hour urinary vanillin mandelic acid levels. The symptom of anxiety may be associated with hypoglycemia as well as hyperglycemia. Psychosis and personality changes may be associated with various illnesses. Have a look at the slide. It's showing you the various illnesses in which there may be psychosis or personality changes. Number one is Wilson disease. That's related to the copper metabolism. And you might find more copper getting excreted in the urine and decreased serum ceruloplasmin levels. Acute intermittent porphyria will be associated with increased D-aminolevulinic acid levels, porphobilinogen, as well as the presence of leukocytosis. Conditions like SLE, systemic lupus erythematosus, and rheumatoid arthritis, you may find positive anti-nuclear antibodies, positive ANA, antiphospholipid antibodies, rheumatoid factor, as well as presence of anemia. The condition like AIDS dementia may be positive HIV test and low vitamin B12 levels. Hypoparathyroidism may also be associated with the psychotic changes or personality changes, and in this condition we will find decreased calcium. As opposed to this, in hyperparathyroidism we may find increased calcium levels. So it's important to do all these investigations when we are getting psychosis or personality changes, and we will be able to rule out if there is any medical condition associated. Monitoring drug therapy is an important issue of biological assessment. For example, if your patient is suffering from bipolar disease and is receiving lithium, it will be extremely important to do the therapeutic drug monitoring as far as the blood lithium levels are concerned. We also need to monitor the thyroid function as well as the renal function, because these are some of the adverse effects of lithium. The drugs like clozapine and carbamazepine are known to produce agranulocytosis, serious agranulocytosis. So WBC counts are essential, regular WBC counts are essential. And again, the drugs like carbamazepine and valproic acid, they can produce liver damage. So regular liver function tests will be extremely important. Let's go to some diagnostic tests. The important test is dexamethasone suppression test. In this test, what happens in normal person is 1 milligram of dexamethasone suppresses the cortisol secretion. You are giving a steroid, dexamethasone, so it's likely to suppress the cortisol secretion, endogenous cortisol secretion from inside the body. If there's no suppression of this cortisol secretion, this is called as positive dexamethasone suppression test, and this comes positive in 50% of patients with major depressive disorder. The false positive dexamethasone suppression test may be present in various conditions. This includes schizophrenia, dementia, pregnancy, anorexia nervosa, as well as severe weight loss, patients with Cushing's disease, patients with alcohol abuse, and the patients who are withdrawing from benzodiazepines. As opposed to this, false negative dexamethasone suppression test may be found, obviously, in Addison's disease, in the treatment with benzodiazepines, and high-dose corticosteroid treatment. So that's about DST or dexamethasone suppression test. Drug-assisted interviewing is useful in certain situations. You have to administer a sedative drug to the patient. The purpose is to relax the patient and to facilitate coherent verbal expression from the patient. And this is of value in conditions like dissociative disorders as well as the anxiety states, conversion disorders, mute psychotic states, and the patients who are likely to be malingering. Amilobarbitone, that's amobarbital sodium, is used, which is called, the procedure is called amital interview. Other barbiturates can also be used for this purpose, as well as benzodiazepines can also be used for drug-assisted interviewing. Sodium lactate administration is the intravenous administration of sodium lactate, this one, or inhalation of carbon dioxide. This precipitates panic attacks in susceptible individuals. So sodium lactate administration or inhalation of carbon dioxide can be used for diagnosis of panic disorders. Galvanic skin response is an interesting test, and this is used sometimes to detect lying. When there is lying, there is sympathetic arousal, there is sympathetic overactivity. This leads to higher sweat gland activity. And when the sweat gland activity is high, there is decreased skin resistance to the galvanic current. So you pass galvanic current through the skin, and if there is decreased skin resistance, then it becomes a positive test for lying. And this is what you call lie detector test. Of course, this test will be false positive in patients who have anxiety. They are likely to have sympathetic arousal as it is, and this is why the test may come positive, but this patient is not lying, this patient is suffering from anxiety. As opposed to this, those individuals with antisocial personality disorder are likely to have false negative lie detector test. The test will be negative, but the person is lying because this person has antisocial personality disorder. Now we move on to the neurologic evaluation. Structural changes can be identified on CT, that's the computed tomography. For example, enlarged brain ventricles may be found in cognitive and psychotic disorders. Then we can detect the physiological changes by certain investigations. One of them is MRI, that is magnetic resonance imaging. And there's no exposure to ionizing radiation, that's the advantage of MRI. And by MRI, you can detect demyelination and the conditions like multiple sclerosis. Another investigation is PET, that is positive emission tomography, as well as SPECT, is single photon emission computed or coherence tomography. The third one, neurologic evaluation, is again for lying, and this is done by activation of anterior cingulate gyrus. So these are some of the tests, some of the investigations for neurologic evaluation. Next we move on to electroencephalogram. This measures the electrical activity in the cerebral cortex, and in various conditions you can have characteristic features of the EEG or electroencephalogram. For example, in various types of epilepsy we get sharp waves and spikes and paroxysmal activity. In absence seizure, that's petit-mal epilepsy, a typical feature found is 3 per second spike and wave pattern. When the patient is in delirium, the electroencephalogram waves are slowing, the slowing of EEG, because the patient is in delirium, that's clouding of consciousness. And in the patients with dementia, there is normal electroencephalogram. So electroencephalogram can be of extreme value to differentiate between delirium and dementia. In schizophrenia, there's decreased alpha waves, increased theta and delta waves, and there may be epileptiform activity found on EEG. So these are some of the conditions in which EEG can be useful. Evoked EEG or evoked potential is used to test the quantifying electrical activity in response to tactile, auditory, or visual stimuli. So you use electrical activity in response to the tactile, auditory, and visual stimuli. And this is useful especially in infants when you cannot obtain any response, you cannot obtain any verbal response from the infants. So you can evaluate the vision and hearing loss in infants. Again, to evaluate the brain responses in comatose patient and in suspected brain dead patients, you can use evoked EEG. In patients with mental retardation, again, evoked EEG can be of value, because you can evaluate vision and hearing in the patients with mental retardation. So that's about evoked EEG or the evoked potential. Now we go on to discuss what is intelligence and what is achievement and how to test it. What's intelligence? Intelligence is the measure of innate potential for learning or for the abilities to understand. This includes lot many things. For example, abilities for reasoning, abilities to think logically, abilities to come to a conclusion, understanding abstract concepts, assimilate, recall, analyze and organize the information which is provided to the brain, and again meeting the special needs of new situations. All this is included in intelligence. Whereas achievement is the measure of knowledge and skills which are acquired from education and experience. So these are two different issues, intelligence and achievement. One of the important measures of intelligence is intelligent quotient, what you call as IQ. It's a general estimate of functional capacity of brain. And it's calculated as mental age divided by chronological age multiplied by 100. The mean IQ is supposed to be 100 with a standard deviation of 15. And the intelligent quotient values less than 69 indicates mentally disabled patients. 70 to 79 is borderline. 80 to 89 is low average. 90 to 109 is average. That's why we said 100 is the average IQ. 110 to 119 indicates high average IQ. 120 to 129 indicates superior IQ. And more than 129 is very superior IQ. And as written on this particular slide, the first one that's less than 69 and the last one that's more than 129, you're likely to have just 2.5% of patients, 2.5% of persons in each of these two groups according to the standard distribution. Mental retardation is lack of intelligence to a degree that interferes with a person's social and vocational performance. So, based on IQ values, we can classify mental retardation as mild mental retardation, having IQ from 50 to 70. Moderate mental retardation is 35 to 50. Severe is 20 to 35. And profound mental retardation is defined as the intelligent quotient of below 20. Now, there are some intelligence tests which have been shown on this particular table. The first one is Wechsler Adult Intelligence Scale. I have highlighted, underlined and made bold the word adult, and this adult will stand for A when you are abbreviating this test, and it's abbreviated as WAIS-R, that's revised Wechsler Adult Intelligence Scale, and this is usually used for patients more than 17 years of age. Wechsler Intelligence Scale for children, there will be C in the abbreviation, Wechsler W Intelligence I Scale S, and C for children, R is again revised. So WISCR is for the age group between 6 and 17 years. Wechsler Preschool and Primary Scale of Intelligence is for still lower age, and this is why if you look at the abbreviation, it goes as WPPSI, first P standing for preschool, second P standing for primary scale of intelligence, W standing for Wechsler. This is for the age group 4 to 6 years. Stanford Binet Scale, which came in 1905, is the first formal intelligent quotient test or IQ test. So these are some of the intelligent tests which are commonly used. Let's go to achievement test. Achievement is the measure of knowledge and skills which are acquired from the education and from the information. Examples are Scholastic Aptitude Test, for example, SAT, or Medical College Admission Test, for that matter, MCAT, is an achievement test, or a United States Medical Licensing Examination, USMLE, or there is another test called Wide Range Achievement Test, which is called WRAT. California, LOVA, Stanford, and Peabody Achievement Test are the various intelligence achievement tests used in various states. Now we go to Personality and Psychopathology Test. Personality and Psychopathology Test are divided into objective tests and projective tests. In objective tests, there are simple stimuli. For example, there are questions. Whereas in projective tests, there are ambiguous stimuli. In the objective test, the responses are restricted and they are scored mechanistically using a key. There are questions, the patient is going to answer the questions, and you have a mechanistic key to grade or to score the responses. So I am saying in objective test, the responses are restricted. Whereas in projective test, you get wide range of responses, and to understand all these responses, you have to have experienced clinicians. They have to use the consensual standards, and these are the clinicians, expert clinicians, who are going to score them. So there's wide range of responses in projective tests. In objective test, there's no clinical experience required to score because there's a mechanistic key involved depending on the answers given by the patient. Whereas in projective test, expertise and clinical experience is required to obtain information, to obtain conclusions from the wide range of responses. Let's have a look at the examples, then it's going to be clear for you what is objective and what is projective. For example, the last row of the first column, Minnesota Multiphasic Personality Inventory, MMPI, or Million Clinical Multiaxial Inventory, is MCMI, or ISANC Personality Inventory, EPI, or 16PF Inventory. These are the examples of objective tests. Whereas projective tests are Rorschach Ink Block Test, Thematic Apperception Test, TAT, Sentence Completion Test, SCT, or Projective Drawings. So these are all projective tests. The patient is going to do drawings, patient is trying to complete the sentence, and based on how the patient is completing a sentence or how the patient is drawing, making various drawings, you're going to have the projective idea of what's going on in the mind of the patient. Let's go further to discuss the objective test. Minnesota Multiphasic Personality Inventory, MMPI, there are 566 questions which are true or false type of questions which are going to test various 10 clinical dimensions. In the Million Clinical Multiaxial Inventory 2, that's MCMI 2, there are 175 items, true or false type of items, and again is going to test the various clinical dimensions. These two tests, objective tests, are useful in the diagnosis of depression, schizophrenia, paranoia, and hypochondriasis. Whereas when we go to projective test, the ideas are different. The first one, Rorschach Ink Blot Test, there are 10 ink blots, 5 are in black and 5 are in color, and the patient is going to be shown the ink blot, and the patient is going to write, or the patient is going to say, what are the thoughts coming to the patient's mind after looking at these ink blots. So I'm calling it projective, it cannot be objective. And this is useful in the diagnosis of thought disorders and to understand the various defense mechanisms which are undertaken by this patient. The next one, Thematic Apperception Test, or TAT, is making a story from pictures. The patient is shown various pictures and the patient is asked to make a story. And based on the way the patient makes the story, we get a projective idea of what's going on in the mind of the patient. This is going to evaluate the unconscious conflicts in the mind of the patient, the unconscious drives, the motives, and the emotions in the mind of the patient. The next one is Sentence Completion Test, or SCT, where an incomplete sentence is given to the patient and patient is going to complete the sentence. Based on the way of completing the sentence, you can understand the fears in the mind of the patient, the desires in the mind of the patient's aspirations, and sometimes you can also have an idea about the relationships of the patient. I hope you understand, it's a complex test, it's a projective test, and you need expertise, clinical experience to analyze, to organize, and to draw conclusions from this projective test. The last one is projective drawing. For example, drawing a house, drawing a tree, drawing persons, or drawing the family of the patient. Now you look at the way the patient has done it based on the size of the picture, the size of a particular object shown in the drawing, the placement, the clarity, the distortion, the erasures, if the patient erases and remakes the picture, the details which the patient is showing and the things which the patient is omitting, and the way the patient is shading a particular drawing, you can interpret the unconscious forces in the mind of the patient. So this is something which is hidden in the mind of the patient and is trying to come out by various expressions the patient is expressing, by the way of completing a sentence, by the way of completing a story, by the way of writing the thoughts looking at the ink blots, or by the way of a projective drawing So I hope now you understand it well. These are all projective tests. In the objective test, you have definite questions and the patient is giving definite responses. So you have a mechanistic scoring key, and that's why you can come to some objective conclusions. So those are called objective tests. And whatever we discussed, these four just now, are the projective tests. Next, we go to the mental status examination, or MSE. What is tested? There are five important issues which are tested on the mental status examination. If you look at the headings on this particular slide, you test the general presentation of the patient, cognition, emotional state of the patient, thought and perception of the patient, and what is the judgment and insight, as well as the reliability and impulse control. Let's go to them one by one. General presentation: the appearance of the patient, the behavior, the attitude towards the examiner, and the level of consciousness. This is tested in general presentation. As far as the cognition is concerned, we test the orientation of the patient. Orientation, the time, place, person, the memory, the capacity of attention, concentration, the cognitive ability, and the speech. These are all the aspects of cognition. In the emotional state, we test the mood and affect of the patient. In the thought and perception, we try to analyze and understand the form of thought, the process of thought, the content of thought, and the perception of the thought. And we also test the judgment and insight, as well as the reliability and the impulse control of the patient. So this is a brief idea about the mental state examination. There is another examination, mental state examination, which is comparatively a simpler test. It's called MMSE. It's not mental state, it's mini mental state examination. Why mini? Because it's comparatively a brief, comparatively a smaller examination. And it's called Falstein Mini Mental State Examination. And this can be used even by primary care physicians as a bedside test for central nervous system dysfunction, for assessing the central nervous system dysfunction. What are the things which are tested on this? The first one is orientation to time, place, and person is tested. Approximately 3 points are given to each of them, time, place, person. So it makes roughly 10 points. Language is tested by the method of naming the object, asking the patient to name an object. This goes for 8 points. Attention and calculation capacity of the patient is assessed. So that's calculation, 5 points. Registration, that is asking the patient to repeat the names of 3 objects. So 3 points for 3 objects. Then recall, patient hears something and the patient has to recall after 5 minutes. This goes for 3 points. And construction, that is a design is given to the patient and the patient is going to copy the design. So this stands for 1 point. So if you make the total on the extreme right column, 10, 8, 5, 3, 3, 1, it comes to 30 points. So the total maximum score on MMSE, Falstein Mini Mental State Examination, will be 30 points. If the points are if the score is less than 25, is going to indicate cognitive problems, and if the score is less than 20, is going to indicate significant impairment. So that's about Falstein Mini Mental State Examination. I would advise you to remember this. They are likely to ask you, which is a simple bedside test for the testing of CNS dysfunction. It's called MMSE, Falstein Mini Mental State Examination. Next, we go to understand what is GCS, or Glasgow Coma Scale. This is regarding the consciousness of the patient. There are 3 issues in testing the consciousness. E stands for eye opening, and this is scored from 1 to 4. V stands for the verbal response of the patient, is scored from 1 to 5. And M stands for motor response of the patient. This is scored from 1 to 6. Now, for example, if we have a patient, arbitrarily, let's take some values. Eye opening is 2, verbal response is 2, and the motor response is 3. Then I'm going to write it as E2, V2, M3. Eye opening 2, E2, verbal response 2, V2, and the motor response 3 is M3. And in front of it, I'm going to write is equal to GCS, that's Glasgow Coma Scale, make an addition of 2 plus 2 plus 3 is 7. So I'm going to write it as GCS7. The highest score in the Glasgow Coma Scale will be 15, obviously. If the score is between 12 to 15, it indicates mild impairment. Between 9 to 12 indicates moderate impairment, and less than 9 is going to indicate severe neurologic impairment. Next, we come to the rating scales for depression. There are various scales available. The most commonly used is BAKE, Depression Inventory 2, that is BDE2. There is direct interrogation. It's easy to apply, and the primary care physicians can do this. There are 21 items, and the scoring from 0 to 3, and if the score is more than 30, it indicates severe depression. The other rating scales are Zung Self-Rating Depression Scale, Hamilton Rating Scale for Depression, that's HAM-D, and Ruskin Depression Scale. Vineland Social Maturity Scale is used to test the skills or activities of daily living, and this is especially useful in patients who are mentally retarded or the patients who have got impaired vision or hearing. And the purpose of Vineland Social Maturity Scale is to test the activities, the capacity to do the activities or skills of daily living. Next, we go to the neuropsychologic test. And I have formed a nice table. You can have a look at the table. It's going to tell you which is the test on the left column, and the right column is going to tell you what is the purpose of doing this test and what is it going to detect. Halstead Return Battery is useful for localizing the lesion in the brain. Luria Nebraska Battery is useful for right-left specific dysfunction to identify which side it has specifically got the dysfunction. Bender Visual Motor Gestural Test and Benton Visual Retention Test, these two tests are useful for visual motor function, that's recall, memory, spatial orientation, and construction of designs. All this will be involved. So you can look at the two tests, Visual Motor Gestural Test, Bender Visual Motor Gestural Test, and Benton Visual Retention Test. So this is regarding the visual motor function. And the last one indicated on the slide is Wechsler Memory Scale. This is going to test the memory of the patient, the recent as well as the remote memory of the patient. So I think we went through various biological tests, various methods of biological assessment to rule out the conditions, medical conditions, which may be associated with psychological symptoms. And then we went to discuss what is intelligence, achievement, and what are the various tests used. And finally, we also did the neuropsychologic test. I'm sure this module is going to be useful to you. And because there are many difficult words, many difficult names involved on this particular module, which is telling you about the various tests, I think it will be essential for you to remember all these terms so that you can solve some of the nice multiple choice questions, which are definitely going to give you a lot of scoring. Please don't forget Vineland Social Maturity Scale, and this is to test the skills of activities of daily living. I'm going giving you a hint because this is likely to be forgotten. I hope you enjoy the module, and we'll meet on more modules, more presentations, and continue our interesting discussion of psychiatry. Thank you very much for your patient listening. Bye. Best of luck.